conversation around these topics. I pray for these parents as they raise these kiddos, whether these are their oldest emerging into high school or their youngest or somewhere in the middle. Lord, we just pray that you would go before them and their kids as they make this transition. And thank you for them. In Jesus' name, amen. So we are talking tonight about the exciting transition from junior high to high school. I know when I will be meeting with your students in a couple of weeks and talking with them, giving them a lot of the same information that you'll be getting tonight. And it's always fun to see their faces and the smiles and thinking about no longer being in junior high and transferring into high school and all the fun things that come with that. So I know that they're excited for that. Hopefully you're excited for that. Hopefully we can answer a lot of the questions you may have about it tonight and give you some good information to walk away with tonight. This will all be on our website, so if you need to rewatch it, if you'd like, I don't have handouts tonight, but if you would like a copy of this PowerPoint, just email me and I'd be happy to get that to you. Okay. So you're going to hear from several of us tonight in a lot of different areas of the school. Hopefully get a chance to ask each one of us the questions that you may have in our particular departments. So as we go and as we start, we always like to start with our mission statement. For those of you who have been here for a long time, you may have this memorized, but we always like to go over it because it really is the heart of what we do. We come back to this over and over again as a staff and as a leadership team as we talk about implementing new things, as we evaluate how we're doing with the things that we're already doing and already implementing, to really make sure that we're in line with what we feel is the mission that God's given us. So I'm just going to read it to you one more time. In partnership with Christian families and local churches, and partnership is very important to us, we develop the whole person by shepherding our students through a Christ-centered education, challenging them to achieve their fullest potential spiritually, academically, socially, physically, relationally, and preparing them with the foundation of God's unchanging truth so that they can serve Christ in a rapidly changing world. There's a few words in our mission statement that really stand out to me personally. And the first of those things, and hopefully you've heard us talk about this with your students as they've gone through junior high as well, but the older they get, and as we start talking about them emerging into adulthood, growing into adulthood, that focus on the whole person is really important to us. So we know, and research tells us, and we know from our own observation and experience, both as parents and as staff, that our students are not just a brain sitting in a seat in a classroom. Okay? We know that they show up every day carrying emotions, thinking thoughts, in physical bodies that they're dealing with, in circumstances and in life situations that they're bringing into the classroom every single day as they learn. And so our job and our desire as staff, as teachers, as mentors here on this campus in their lives is to really know them as whole people and to address them in such a way every day in the classroom that acknowledges that they are whole people and really begin to get to know them on all of those different levels of their lives. Because we really believe that that enhances learning, and research proves that that's true. And then shepherding our students, obviously the most important part of what we do. We want to be academically rigorous, but first and foremost, we want our kiddos to know Christ and to know his love, and to come out of here knowing that they're loved and being able to take that knowledge and that foundation into whatever lies before them beyond high school. So hopefully what you hear tonight, the rest of the time, will reflect that, and just want to reiterate that the importance of all of that to you tonight. So what can your student expect in high school? Well, there are some more opportunities than they've had in the past to grow. In their capacity and their opportunities broaden as they get older. They're moving from the one elective and six core classes to two electives and five core classes. That's one thing that they usually look forward to, is a little bit more breadth that way. Spiritually, they continue with their advisory groups, Bible classes begin to change. They're going to move into ninth grade Bible, having done the Old Testament. They're going to start with a survey of the New Testament in ninth grade, and then we're going to give them options in sophomore and junior year to grow and to really zero in on certain aspects of God's Word and of their spiritual lives that they want to explore in more depth. Opportunities to serve and to be in ministry, both on campus, in our local community here, and in the world. We'll be talking with them about missions opportunities and service opportunities that you guys might want to think about as a family, getting them involved in as well. Academically, more challenging courses. The breadth of courses opens up as they enter high school. We have honors courses available and AP courses available. Sarah Wall's going to walk you through the particulars of that in just a minute. The breadth of our electives increases as well in high school. And then relationally, and this is really important to us too, and we want to encourage you to encourage your students. If they don't already feel like they're connected to staff people in particular, that you would encourage them to foster those relationships with teachers, with coaches, with advisory leaders, because they're going to continue to have great opportunities to get to know adults on this campus as well as their peers. And increasing opportunities for them to interact with one another, continuing in their advisory groups. They might want to get involved in mentoring, in our mentoring program, in student leadership. There's just a variety of different ways that they can get to know other students beyond just their small circle of friends that they may have right now. And then more opportunities to lead as well. And we're really going to encourage our eighth graders. I'm going to talk with them a lot about leadership. They'll be invited to a summer opportunity for student leadership to find out what that's all about, to learn from some older students that have been involved in our leadership council this year. Matt Beglinger and I oversee that. And we just have some exciting things that we've developed with our students this year that we're going to continue with going into next year as well. Here's what I'd like you guys to do as parents at home. I think it's easy when you're transitioning from one grade level to another, and you know they're starting out their first day of school, so come mid-August, they will be transitioning into ninth grade, right? And every grade level is a little bit different, and we do our best to try to prepare them for that, and they get so excited about the first day of school. But some good conversations that you could have with your students over the summer would be, this is really kind of the first day of the rest of your life. And not in an overwhelming kind of way, but it's an exciting way. It's an exciting thing. We're going to start to do some things with them in ninth grade that some of our other staff people will tell you about that will help them to know themselves better. And we'll start to help them think ahead. So they're thinking about, what do I want all of high school to look like? Who do I want to be? What are the things, the activities, the interests, the passions that I want to explore and further develop in my life? And obviously, then the older you get, older they get, helping them think beyond high school and how the Lord may want to use them and what they want to do after high school as well. What matters most in high school? Well, we think character matters most. And so this summer, at the end of, they're wrapping up junior high and they're making this transition into the more mature end of the spectrum on this campus, it's a really good time for them, for you to talk with them about who do you want to be? What's going on in your character right now? What things have you noticed about yourself this year? Rebecca Smith is going to chat with you a little bit after I explain it in more depth about the Strengths Finder. And you as parents, when they take the Strengths Finder in ninth grade, you're going to get an assessment of them that's going to help you understand your child better and them understand themselves better. So you can begin to have those conversations about how those things might be life-shaping for them in the 4 years of high school that they're here. Every grade counts now, and that's something that I emphasize pretty strongly when I meet with the students, that they are, from the minute they walk on campus as a ninth grader, they are developing something called a transcript. And that transcript is pretty important. And it follows them beyond high school and really is something that they need to be aware of and taking responsibility for early on. A lot of seniors, juniors, In terms of the classes that they take, we always encourage students to take the most rigorous courses that they feel like they can handle while still maintaining the GPA that they would like to maintain. So the most rigorous courses they can handle while still being in that sweet spot of their GPA. So we would always encourage a kiddo who would like to try an honors course, try an AP course, even if they're a little bit squeamish about it at first, just step into it, go for it, try it out, see how it feels, and you may be surprised at how well you can do in those classes. So we want to encourage them in that way. And then a solid commitment to a few activities in high school is generally better than being spread too thin. So of course we have students that like to play every sport, and that's great, and they have all kinds of activities going on. But as they get older, they may want to start to narrow those things and really try to excel in certain areas. And in terms of service, it's great for them to kind of discover, what are the things that I'm really passionate about? Where are areas that I would really like to get involved, and so I'm not just checking the box of doing my service hours, but I'm actually involved in something that matters to me, that makes a difference, where I feel like I'm contributing something that's important. So a couple of different tips there. The Strengths Quest is something that, how many of you are familiar with the Strengths Finder assessment? Okay, a few of you. So the Clifton Strengths Finder is something that we have started implementing this year, so every staff person on all of our campuses have been through the Strengths Finder assessment. And we are just starting to pilot it with our students. So there's a couple different tiers of assessment for this. They have a Strengths Explorer that is designed for 10 to 14 year old students that some of our 5th and 6th graders have taken on the elementary campus. And I had privilege of working with Rebecca Smith on giving the assessment and then kind of walking the kids through it. We invited parents to be there, and it was just so fun to just see their eyes light up. And it's a little bit smaller version of the larger adult test, but it gives them their top 3 strengths out of a possible 10, and really helps them understand themselves and who they are and how God's wired them, helps them understand how they work best in groups. So it's a great thing to do at that age. And then we're going to begin implementing with our 9th graders every year. Our current 9th graders have taken this already. So your students will take it pretty close to the beginning of the school year in the fall. And it's the Strengths Quest, which is designed for students. So that assessment will give them their top 5 strengths out of a possible 34. And then I walk them through a seminar in which they understand what a strength actually is. We talk about that a strength is a talent, which is an innate, God-given thing that the Lord has equipped you with, that you then are aware of, and you make an investment in yourself. So you learn about it, you use your knowledge, you build skills, you have practice, you have experience to further develop that talent into a strength. And so we walk them through that process. We help them understand what their top 5 strengths mean, and it's a great exercise to walk kids through, not only for them to understand themselves better and for them to take that home and share that with you so that you guys can talk about that as a family and you can understand one another better, but it also really helps them understand each other better and their classmates better. So when they're working in groups in different projects and different subject areas, and they're aware of one another's strengths, they can really learn to appreciate each other a lot more by having walked through that process already. We will be using this
introduce you to really my leadership team. And so I consider my leadership team to be my department chairs, in addition to Kristen, in addition to Matt Beglinger, in addition to Jackson Kramer, and in addition to Becky Folk and Rebecca Smith. So you'll hear a little bit about each of those people tonight. And most of my half of the people I mentioned are actually here. Will be here tonight for you. I'm standing in on behalf of my department chairs. My department chairs aren't here tonight. So I'm going to kind of introduce you to them via our slides here, and to let you know that, of course, these are my content experts. They help lead their departments in content, in curriculum, in scope and sequence. They meet with the elementary school staff and help inform really what's happening pre-K through 12, okay, and beyond, making sure that we're hitting all the right notes and the right marks in all of my content areas. Still, their main focus is the discipling of our kiddos and their relationships with Jesus, okay? That is their focus. But of course, they are my content experts. So we have the bottle department that is co-led by three people. Actually, Dwayne Gray is on our school board, is an elder of Cole Community. He helps with my Bible department. I consider him a co-leader, co-chair of that department, in addition to Alex Canfield and Jay Seals. The reason you do not see their pictures up there is because they perhaps, maybe, they were posing, maybe at least, particularly Alex Canfield, and it just didn't seem like we should even post the picture, so we skipped that. But here's Donna Lee, and she's my English department chair. She has her master's degree, and then my three other department chairs, Tim Bergren, who also has his master's, Brennan Koch for science, he has his master's degree, as does Dixie Herring, my history department chair, and you'll hear from her later tonight about the DC trip, okay? And then we've got Becky Folk, who is our SAS department director, and has just done an amazing job with that department that started off with just like 1.5 people, maybe, back in the day, and now has grown to a really vibrant department that actually we actually even had guests this past week touring this campus and meeting with her and her staff, as well as our third campus, to try to get information about how are we doing what we do with our kiddos who have education plans and that need a little extra assistance, and we kind of take a tiered approach to that. And this programmatically is something you're not gonna see on other Christian school campuses. You're not gonna actually see it on other public school campuses, but God has really blessed us with an amazing staff there that is just really taking hold of the vision that really, if God brings a family to our doorsteps, we pray we have the resources, right? We pray we have the resources to help equip their kiddo, and we have a place for them here is our hope. And we do have quite a few resources, not every one available, but as God provides, we try to do our best there. So I am here tonight. If you've got questions about specific content areas, curriculum things, curriculum kind of questions, you can come find me. Like I said, I'm kind of standing in for my department chairs, but you'll be able to meet most of the rest of my, well, Becky Folk is in California, that's why she's not introducing herself right now. Matt Beglinger will be here tonight. He's my vice principal. You'll hear from Rebecca Smith. You've already heard from Kristen. Am I missing anybody else? I keep saying names. And Sarah, you'll definitely hear from Sarah tonight. Next, we've got Rebecca Smith.
Hello, I get to talk to you about our individual student growth plans. So for the past several years, our goal has been to have an individual plan for every student. And this year we got to roll out individual plans with our ninth graders, and we will continue that with your students next year. students to take ownership of their learning. And so having a plan that they own and that they put into and collaborate with their teachers on and hopefully in the future their advisory leaders on really helps them to be able to take ownership of their academic growth, their spiritual growth, all of that. It also helps us to focus on growth. Every kid comes in at a different level, and so we want to make sure we're meeting them where we're at, so we want to focus on that with the plans. So I'm just going to show you a couple key parts of the plan. I just have examples up here. I'm not going to read through the whole thing. Kristen talked to you about the strengths quest that we have students take. So it gives them their top five strengths, and it gives them a report. So what we did with the ninth graders this year is we helped them read through their reports. They picked one strength that they really resonated with the most. For a lot of kids, it was their number one strength. For some, it was another one in the top five. And then they created a goal based on that strength. There's a report that kind of helps them create goals. And then we had them come up with an action plan on how they're going to accomplish that goal. And we're going to revisit that later this year. This is housed digitally, so we can go back in and it will follow students all through their high school years. It's through their Office 365 account, so you'll have access as well as parents if you just go into their account. So I'll give you all those details next year with that. So we start with strengths because we want everything to be focused around their strengths. They can't grow if they don't know their strengths. So that's really a key part there. The next thing we do is we talk about where they're at with testing. So this is a student's PSAT testing. So we walk them through, you guys as parents get those reports. You know what some of it means, not all of it. So we walk the kids through their PSATs so that they understand them. And then they can see, like on here, it'll have all their years. So they have their eighth grade. And so they can see this student had a 1270. The benchmark was an 860. So they were well above the benchmark. But our key here is their growth from last year. So this student grew 75 points, which is well above average in growth. So we really look at that. And then students can see, PSAT is a good indicator for how students will do on the SAT later. So we talk through all of that with students, and we'll give you more information on that as well. So then they can look and see how they need to grow in their testing throughout the years. Do they need to do certain things? How are classes preparing them and all of that? So they filled these charts in with as we went through their reports. So they took ownership of all of this. And then the last main part is self-evaluation of learning. Each class has essential learning outcomes. Those are the big objectives for the class. And so the teacher puts the ELOs in there, and as they go through the year, students determine whether or not they mastered the ELO and put in evidence that show that. So this is a writing example. So after this essay, students received a rubric back, and so they could see what they mastered and what they didn't from the teacher, and then even have conversations with the teacher to help them see that. So they're evaluating their mastery. Then they get the opportunity to rewrite an essay if they realize they didn't master what they needed to do there or in different subjects it looks different. So it's really them taking that ownership so that they make sure that they get all of the content mastered and they know what they've mastered and what they need to keep working on. So that's the big picture. You'll get more information on this next day with your students. So next up is Todd McQueen, our technology extraordinaire.
What these are, I'd like to talk a little bit about why we have it this way. environment. A lot of teachers do a lot of different things in their classrooms, and we try and maintain as much consistency for the student and the family as we can. So if we open it up widely to a range of devices, then we start limiting. So certain devices will only be able to run certain things, or the student won't be able to use a program in a particular class. So maybe in that case, they would have to have multiple devices. So we're trying to limit it down to just some specifics. So some Windows computers, Macs, those work great. We have a set of tablets as well. These are systems, not like iPads, right? iPads can only run apps from app stores, and same with some of the Samsung tablets. So we're trying to broaden that out by allowing them to be able to install software on their devices. We also have a list of devices that aren't acceptable for use, and this is where we start to get into some debate sometimes. Chromebooks are easily affordable, but can't install software on them. And we've unfortunately had a couple of instances where someone showed up with a Chromebook and we just can't make it work. Please feel free to ask questions. I will be around here after we're done, and you can talk to me about that if you have any questions. But I should, let's see. Yep. I think that pretty much covers it. There's one thing that's going to change. For those of you that have had students here for the past couple of years or other high school students, this is something we haven't done before, but this year every student's going to have an email address, and it's going to be in the cbcsonline.org domain. So, and that's part of a direction that we're moving with more collaboration between the teachers and the students, and being able to facilitate that a little bit better. So that'll be something that's kind of new, and takes some getting used to, but feel free to ask about that. I understand one of the things that comes up a lot of times is kind of security and what we're doing for that. I'd be happy to talk about all of that and the steps we take to try and lock things down a little bit around here too. All right, looks like Sarah is up next.
Okay, so beginning next year, your guys' kids are going to be able to be choosing whether or not they're in an honors science or an honors English class. In 7th and 8th grade, those weren't available to them, but beginning in the 9th grade, they are. The only classes that there are grading testing requirements to participate in the honors level is the math sections. So typically, if your kiddos are already in Honors Algebra 1, or they're an 8th grader who has completed Algebra 1 with the correct grade, then we will move them on to the next honors math class, which is Honors Geometry. Now, if they don't finish in the grade parameters that the department heads have set up, then we reevaluate that choice when we go into scheduling. Okay? Beginning in 9th grade, we like all of the 9th graders to be in biology. They will have the choice of honors biology or regular biology. As 10th graders, they may take chemistry or honors chemistry, as well as Honors English 9, Honors English 10, okay? Then when they get on into 11th grade, they move into the AP sections. AP stands for Advanced Placement. It's run through the College Board, which we will talk about in a little bit. But mostly, the most important thing to remember about those Honors and AP sections is more work. It's not just honors on your transcript. It is more work, it's a deeper dive, and the expectations on those students are higher, and it's okay if they choose not to take them. We are weighting the honors and AP classes on a 5-point scale instead of a 4-point scale. What does that mean? It means that when a transcript is printed after the 9th grade, if your kids took 3 honors classes, then those classes will be weighted on a 5-point scale. The rest of the classes are weighted on a 4-point scale. So if your student gets all A's, then they have the opportunity to earn like a 4.3 GPA. Now that's a weighted GPA, not an unweighted GPA. Their unweighted GPA I don't know, there's lots of different reasons. But does it affect their college entrance? And the answer is no. Colleges use their own weighting scales because up until this year, we did not turn out a weighted GPA. So the colleges will break down all of the classes that your kids have taken and put it through their own calculator anyway. Okay? Additionally, starting next year, and even in the eighth grade, we offered a concurrent credit class this year. Your student will have the opportunity to be taking concurrent credit classes. Now, we offer those classes through several different venues, CWI, NNU, and next year we're hoping to have psychology through BSU. Concurrent credits confuse a lot of people, okay? What does it mean? Concurrent credit class means that you're taking that class to meet a high school requirement as well as a college requirement. That's a good and a bad thing, right? So if your student, you know that they're going to do well, then it's fine. It's going to be on their high school transcript, but it is also going to be on their college transcript. So if you have a student who maybe isn't awesome at history or who isn't awesome at English, and yet you sign them up for a concurrent credit class, what that, and they end up with a C, let's say. They're going to have a C on their high school transcript for ninth grade, whatever. But they are also going to have that on their college transcript. And on every single college application, it will ask them, have you taken a college class before graduation? Their answer needs to be yes, because they have taken it, even though it was taken in high school. So they, when they apply, those transcripts follow them as well. Okay, so if you've taken five concurrent credit classes at CWI and you're applying to Arizona State and they ask you, have you taken how many classes, how many credits, we fill that in, right? And then that transcript from CWI goes along with their transcript from Coal Valley. And Arizona State or whoever evaluates all of it together, okay? Now the great thing about our concurrent credit classes here, the year-long classes are early American history, which they will have as ninth graders, as well as all of the English classes. They are year-long classes that they do not register for until the beginning of February, which means you get to see how well they've done that whole first semester and into second semester, and that way you can make a better choice about, we got a C minus first semester, maybe we don't want the college credit. Or they killed it with a 98, maybe we do want that college credit. The cost for college credits is $195 per class, and that is the same in all three venues that we use. Psychology will most likely be offered for juniors and seniors. In addition to this list, we also are offering Spanish 1, 2, and 3 for concurrent credit through CWI. Let's talk about the difference between a concurrent credit class and an AP class. Everybody always asks me this. AP classes here at Coal Valley are typically offered to juniors and seniors. So concurrent credit classes are offered this year. We began them in eighth grade, and anyone can take those during any school year that it's offered. The AP classes we offer to 11th and 12th graders is open enrollment, so you do not have to be on the honors track to take an AP class here. An AP class spends an entire year preparing kids with the knowledge base they need to pass that particular test. Now, our AP classes are also taught for concurrent credit. So theoretically, your student can take that class for the entire year, take the AP test, it is graded on a 1 to 5 scale. If they quote unquote pass, which is a different grade at every college, then they get concurrent credit for that class without taking it as a concurrent credit class. So let me give you here, they just can't, they're not ready for them for our classes. Let's see. Is there a foreign language requirement? There is no foreign language requirement for Coal Valley or for the state of Idaho. Should your student take a foreign language? It really entirely depends on A, do they want to? B, where do they think they want to go to college? Because although none of our colleges in our tri-state area have that as a requirement, most schools in other states do have it as a requirement. So if your student is wanting to go down south, into California or back east, most of those colleges have a 2 or 3-year foreign language concurrently taken requirement. So the best way to find out if your kid's dream school is Duke and you want to know what is it that they need to be preparing for in order to give them acceptance to Duke, you need to go out onto the Duke's admissions website or whichever school it is and make sure that you fully understand the admissions requirements. And if it says 3 years of a foreign language, then chances are they really want your kid to have 3 years of a foreign language. Now here we're offering Spanish 1, 2, and 3. We're also offering French 1, 2, and 3. Okay? How many lab sciences are required or recommended? So here, we offer many. Only one is required. I like them to take 2 or 3, but I also understand that science is not every kid's forte. So once they complete biology, which everybody gets the amazing opportunity to do as freshmen, whether it be regular or honors biology, that does fulfill their lab requirement. Then they can move on to chemistry, or they can move on to applied science, they can move on to intro to robotics, anatomy. There are several other classes that they can move on to. Some have the lab and some do not have a lab. What are the benefits of AP courses versus dual credit? The dual credit classes, you know for sure your kid is going to get the credit. You've paid the $195. They may end with a C and, you know, it's on their college transcript, but you know that if you pay the $195, they love the credit, okay? With an AP class and the AP test, you don't have a guarantee that they are going to earn those credits unless they score into the category that their desired university wants them to score to get those credits. Does that make sense? Okay. Does anybody have any questions before we move on to high school profile? Sure, Joe Kasuba does.
Absolutely. That tests your knowledge.
Yeah.
Okay, so this is probably a stupid question.
There's no stupid questions.
Just to clarify, when you had that screen about the AP classes and concurrent credit, and like the example you had BSU with the psychology, is that taught on campus or would students have to actually go to BSU?
Yeah, that's a good question. So all concurrent credit classes are taught here by staff members who have been approved by that institution to teach those classes here on the campus. So for example, the dual credit early American history is taught here. That means that CWI sent someone out here from their history department to audit Mrs. Herring's class. They approved her, so she is given the ability to teach at that college level. So we are in the process of going through that with BSU right now for psychology. But it will be taught here, all of them are taught here. Yeah.
And CWI bills us direct.
Yes.
It's not through the school's tuition program.
Yeah, that's a good question. So the registration is all done online. Okay, some teachers choose to do it in their class, and others teachers will send you an email with a link to complete that registration. We run all of our registration through a company called Dual Enroll, and they are partners with us and CWI, but they are a third-party registration. So once you establish an account, right, you'll create another username and password. That is good for as long as your student is taking classes through CWI. So Dual Enroll, once you've completed that process, they send that information to CWI. Their registrars input the data into their system, and then a bill is generated that goes directly to you.
Well, I just got my bill.
Yeah, congratulations.
Sure.
Yes, I got mine too. So, and you can pay it online. You can send them a check. There's lots of four concurrent credits, then they entered as a sophomore, and that meant that they did not qualify for the freshman scholarships. That typically is not true, at least in our tri-state area right now. Now, if you look at East Coast schools or schools in the South, I can't guarantee that for every school because they all have their own set of rules. But for the most part, the schools in our area are not counting any credits that were earned before high school graduation. Okay. Anything else? Okay, building the strong high school profile. So during their freshman year, Ms. Smith and I will be taking some time out of their Bible classes, and we're going to be launching the Freshman Cornerstone program this next year. So this is going to be an opportunity for us to, first and foremost, do the strengths finders with them, go through their profile, help them understand, what their strengths are and how we can use that to their benefit. That's the first part. Then the next part is we really want them to fully grasp the idea of high school, right? Mrs. Overton was totally right when she said there are so many kids that come sit in my office as juniors and seniors and they wasted their freshman year and their transcripts are filled with C's and D's and now they really want to go to college next year. And that really puts them in a place where they have to live with the consequences of their choices, right? And so it's our goal to get ahead of that. So this next year, we will be starting with Freshman Cornerstone, and really our sole purpose is to help them understand the gravity of what the transcript means and that it follows you, and what a semester GPA is versus a cumulative GPA, because I have so many kids that come in, after the first semester of their junior year and say, oh my gosh, I have a 4.0. And I said, well, you do for this semester, but when we add it to your 2.2, like it doesn't equal 4.0. So helping them understand just the sheer math of their transcript so that there's no surprises, right? Because believe it or not, parents get mad at me, they don't get mad at their kids. So we really want to help everybody understand, yes, high school is supposed to be fun, but it's also gonna be with you forever when you go to apply for other things. So first and foremost, Freshman Cornerstone will happen probably during the first 6 weeks of their freshman first semester. We're gonna be borrowing a little time from Bible, so we need to work that out. Again, encouraging your kids to have strong relationships with staff. Please encourage your students to actually talk to the teacher when they have a grade issue or, oh, I promise I turned in the homework, she just didn't grade it, right? Because the reality of it is their job in high school to have that communication with the teachers. Now, there's always going to be some point where a parent needs to step in, right? But we are trying to really encourage kids to be advocates for themselves, because when they do that, they develop this relationship with staff members that really, grows a lot of trust between those two. We talked about GPA. This is funny. I have so many kids that come into my office, and we will so be talking about this in Freshman Cornerstone, who don't understand why if their assignment was due on a Tuesday and they wrote it in their agenda on a Tuesday, why they didn't remember to turn it in because they didn't do it the night before. So we will so be covering that in Freshman Cornerstone. We will be talking about the SAT and ACT tests during their freshman year, but only as it applies to the PSAT, because that is what they will be taking. But a lot of kids, we need to give them encouragement for why are we doing this testing? Why took this test last year? Why do we have to take it again this year? So, and yes, it is. And how serious they take it is completely up to them. We can't make them go in and take the test seriously. And trust me, we can usually tell who did and who did not take the test seriously. But it is helpful to us, but they are also tracked by the SAT Corporation to see where their growth is. And then once they get to the junior level, their PSAT serves as their national merit qualifying test. During summers, plan your summers thoughtfully. What does that mean? During summers, it's a great opportunity for touring colleges, doing volunteer work, maybe having a little part-time job once they get old enough. As kids start applying to colleges, what they're looking for, not even just grade-wise or activity-wise, is what have you committed to over a period of time and stuck with it, right? Like, we have so many kids that are involved in great ministries, and they have been since they were eighth graders, and that really is what is earning them scholarships, not so much the fact that they're a great volleyball player, okay? I have a lot of parents who, when they come in for conferences with me about academics, they kind of blow me off because they're completely assured that their kid is getting a football scholarship or a volleyball scholarship or whatever. And I'm here to tell you that the majority of full-ride scholarships that our kids are awarded are for academics. They are not for athletics. So, and in addition to that, to be a great candidate for an athletic scholarship, a student needs to be a good student because it makes them the more attractive candidate. If a soccer coach has a choice between a kid with a 3.7 who's going to get $20,000 in academic money from the college, or a kid with a 2.5 who he has to give all the money to come and play for him, who's he going to pick, right? So his budget is affected less by giving money to the kid with the higher GPA than the lower GPA. Does that make sense? The other great activities that our kids are awarded a tremendous amount of money are music, band, and dance, believe it or not, and theater. I think our kids get more academic, band, and arts money than athletics money. Let's see, part-time service. Our registration process is going to be online this year, and it's going to be myself and Mr. Beglinger. We will go into your kids' English classes here in the next couple, 3 weeks, and we will walk them through the registration process for their classes next year. They will choose English. They will choose the math that's appropriate for them. They will choose which science they want. They will choose their electives. Now, the electives at Coal Valley, a lot of people get sad or, you know, not sad about, but it always depends on our staffing. So because we have art this year, we are very hopeful that we will have art next year too, but that's never a guarantee. Which is why when kids do their registration, we have them make, you know, 4 or 5 choices. Because although it's always our goal to give them their top 2 choices, it sometimes doesn't happen. So when they're listing their choices, that's really what we're going for there. Okay, does anybody have any questions for me about registration, about academics, about class choices?
Will something come home to us so that we can have conversations with it before you go through that process of an English class?
So the way we'll do it like we did last year, where the first step will be they will kind of go through the classroom and make a run at what they want. And for some families, that's going to be enough. That'll be fine because you talked about it. But then that will be tied to your email, so you guys will get an email that says, review this, make any changes, and then we input into our spreadsheet the latest one. So like if you guys want to change what your student entered, then that comes into our spreadsheet, and we use that to populate our schedule.
So before you do that, though, will we get a list of the expected electives so we can chat with them before they do that in class?
Well, I think that is the goal of tonight, part of tonight, right, to talk about that for now. Clearly,
I
we have
it could be your goal.
Talked about it. So we have, I mean, you can talk to us, you can talk to me about what is available there, but it's the choices will be on that spreadsheet, so it's like, maybe it seems a little backwards, but they'll make a run at it, and then you can talk to them, and as you go through the spreadsheet, you'll see what the different options are, and you guys can.
Okay.
Right, because once they hit submit, it goes to you so you can review it.
Okay.
So if there's a change that needs to be made, you get the opportunity to do that before we hit submit forever, which isn't really a button. But anybody else have any questions before I turn it over to Mr. Beglinger? Okay.
Good evening. been so far. Pretty awesome. Feels like the energy is super high in this room right now. Okay. Most if not all of you are currently school families, so you know a lot about our culture. I just want to talk a little bit about the jump to high school culturally. High school to me is a time when kids really start to go through the process of making their faith their own. And so I've learned in my time here, my 10 years full time here, that we have kids that are at all ends of the spectrum. Some who are not believers and are here because their parents want them to be and they're open to learn about it, that's great. Some who are really spiritually mature and everybody in between. And so we hope that we're an environment that all of those kids can thrive. Ask their questions. The next thing I have on there is authenticity. If there's a word that you hear from me over and over, that's going to be it. I have no interest in producing kids who know how to look like they're Christians. I think that's super dangerous, and I think that that can really nosedive when they leave home. So we really value hard questions, and we know that we had our seniors talking to the junior high this week, and one of the girls was saying, nobody really told me that I was going to go through times of serious doubt as I tried to figure out who God was in my life, but that's all part of it. You know, is this my belief? Is this my parents' belief? Is this stuff real? Is this a joke? Why don't I go to Rocky? Whatever their questions are, I encourage them to ask them and have those conversations. So that's the approach we're going to take with them, is hopefully they feel safe talking about what they need to talk about. We talk a lot about grace here, and I think that word has a lot of meanings. We just had a staff meeting last Friday talking about grace really is a heart condition more than we don't ever have a consequence or we don't hold you accountable. I think it's very hard to love somebody if you don't hold them accountable. So, but we want to have that culture of forgiveness, that we come alongside you through discipline, even when there is consequences, and hopefully never just this kind of rigid, emotionless process of having kids have to kind of have these if-then things. I like to talk to kids a lot about, you'll hear a lot of, I don't know, kids will say things like, oh, it's just a bunch of hypocrites there, or negative things, or they'll watch certain kids. And I always try to come back to them and say, this is your school, so if there's parts of it that are hard for you, like rather than sitting in the corner and complaining, be a part of the solution and inject positive words and kind of take ownership of that, because I think kids are, especially in high school, are really at an age where it's easy to kind of sit back and look at everybody else and say, you know, these guys are part of the problem. I really encourage kids that you be responsible for you and you know, do the best you can to take accountability for your part of the equation. Social media. Parents, do you have any struggles with your kids and phones and social media? Done? Okay, we are good. The number one for my desk, 80% of the drama, I'm sorry, I need water. 80% of the drama is from electronics. Text conversation, Snapchat, Instagram, whatever it is. And you know that already. We're sort of observing and getting more data on, we're starting to see a pretty predictable life cycle of social media in high school, well, junior high and high school kids. Sixth, seventh grade, you get your iPod that can text, you get your first phone, and it's all new and exciting. Ooh, which boy's the cutest, and kind of these, like, we're talking, but the adults don't know we're talking, but they actually do, but we don't know that they do. And it's kind of innocent and kind of edgy, and then your kids are entering a time where it starts to get dark. It can get dark. We have a group of boys from the sophomore class. We've had some hard conversations with this year just on the things you like on Instagram, the things you post on Instagram. And it's kind of like this weird, like, we're over some of the childish rebellion, and now, hey, I can handle this. Like, this is mature, but hey, we're ninth graders. I mean, come on. And then at some point in there, it bottoms out, and something happens, there's a consequence, they have a friendship that's ruined, whatever it is, and then by the time they're juniors and seniors, they start to kind of realize that there's more life than what your Instagram profile says or whatever, and they still do it, but they're not nearly as glued to the to that social media. And I just feel like I've seen it with my kids, I've seen it with a lot of, you talk to seniors and they're kind of over it, and they still post, but it's nothing like the drama you see in 8th or 9th grade with some of the stuff. So I'm just warning you, I don't have great solutions. If I did, I would have enacted them by now. But just as parents, like, this is such an important time to be as plugged in as you possibly can on how they're using their phones, how much they're using their phones, having times where you just say, hey, we're taking a week off, and we're gonna put our phones away. We've done the Langley thing in July, where we tried to do no technology at all and just say, and it's just great, kids discover like that there's an outside, there's hobbies, and we have a dog apparently. So anyway, just a word to the wise on that. But I also want to be honest with it, like going back to authenticity, struggles are real, kids do and say mean things, and so you guys need to be safe to talk to, I need to be safe to talk to, teachers need to be safe to talk to help them navigate through that stuff. Okay, whoops. Well, thanks for coming, folks. Oh, there we go. Connor Jackson is not here, but that's what he looks like. Handsome young man. He's our new athletic director.
He looks like an 8th grader.
He looks like he is like a year ahead of your kids, but he's actually graduated from college and everything. He's gonna do a great job. He's got a ton of energy and a great vision for our program. And for those of the boys that play football, he coached them last year, I believe, right? So, but what we love the most about Connor through the interview process was he just exudes God's truth. Scripture just comes out of him. He's passionate about it. And I think he's going to do an awesome job in that. So a couple things on athletics. Before we get to this, my number one piece of advice for you as a parent in high school athletics. Are you ready? This is my soapbox. I was AD for 8 years, you know. Is embrace James chapter 1 for your kids. James chapter 1 talks about, why am I blanking on the wording of it? Consider pure joy when you endure trials of many kinds, because those are lead to the testing of your faith, which leads to perseverance, which leads to maturity. Every one of you can probably look to something difficult in your life and say, that was rough, but I grew a ton from it. Right? And so as they get into high school and we have sophomore JV varsity, in some cases like boys basketball, sometimes there's cuts because there's 45 kids that want to try out. Playing time is always an issue. As a parent, if you can take a step back and say, it's hard to see my son or daughter hurting, but I know that if I can walk with them through this on how you go through hard stuff with grace, and how, okay, how do you be a better teammate? How do you be more coachable by your coach? Rather than trying to go and fix the problem, that's one of the best gifts you can give them, I will just say. And I can say that as a dad because I have a senior, sophomore, and 6th grader, and I've had to go through some of that stuff where kid comes home and says, coach hates me. It's like, really? The coach hates you? And just talk through that. I don't get on the email and write a 3-page email. I listen and I say, is it possible that coach is actually trying to make you better? Is it possible that maybe rather than whining, you should go and work hard and practice tomorrow? And just some of that stuff that will go with them for the rest of their lives. And so that's my just parent-to-parent advice. Because at the end of the day, trials in athletics compared to some of the other things they could be having trials in is pretty safe. Didn't play as much in basketball as I wanted to. Yes, that's a bummer, but compared to some huge social drama, I think I would take that, right? And so it's like, it's a pretty safe arena to let your kids fall a little bit and just work with them and just let that do the teaching for them. So some nuts and bolts. You guys have been here, so you know how we work. One of the big things I just like to make sure people understand how it works is our whole academic policy. And so we have, and it's kind of confusing, but once you get it, hopefully it makes sense. That seems obvious. Once you get it, it makes sense. Like most things in life, once you get it, it makes sense. Is my time almost done here?
Yes.
Warm up here. Okay, so there's, we look at their grades 8 times a year for the purposes of eligibility. Mid-quarter and end of quarter. those times, if they have two Ds or one F or worse, they, if they were clean before that, that first time will put them on academic warning. And warning means they can still play in games as long as they're above that line. So let's say mid first quarter, it's football season, your son has two Ds, he's on warning. It means that as long as he's two Ds or lower, he is not suiting up to play games. From mid quarter to end of quarter, he's on warning. Even if he comes above the line, he's still on warning, he's on our list, we're watching him. As long as he stays above the line, he's good. If he's below the line that week, he doesn't play. Pretty straightforward, he can still practice, but parents will ask me, well, can they go on the away games and sit on the bench? I will say, we don't have a rule against it, but if I'm their dad, I'm saying, you are staying home and doing math while your team goes to miss it and play football. Like, that's kind of the idea, is that those game nights can be later, and so that they're held accountable for schoolwork. If at the end of the first quarter they're still at or below that line, they will go on probation, which means for the next period between end of quarter one and mid quarter two, they're totally out. No practice, no games. And there's always some circumstances where if we need to work with a kid, we will, but for the most part, that's pretty reasonable. And it's like, if you've been there for that long, you probably need to prioritize your time. So that's the idea of how that works. You guys, I think, every Sunday can see, I know I see my kids' grades every Sunday, so there's no mystery how they're doing. Usually before a kid misses playing time, I like to double check with teachers that everything's current, that there's not some test that wasn't graded, or because sometimes that happens, and you know, missing a game is a big deal, so we'll definitely double check that, but that's how that works. Those same rules apply to all activities, so not just sports, but drama, art, band. Those ones can be tough, because obviously if you're the lead in the school play, that's a big deal to be like, hey, by the way, I can't be there tonight. So really encourage you, if your kids are in those things and vital parts of those things, if you're watching that and working with them. And I think that's all I have to say about that. I'm going to introduce Dixie. Are there any quick questions about athletics or any of that stuff? Well, it is my distinct privilege to introduce Dixie Herring, ladies and gentlemen.
All right, so I'm passing some stuff out to make this world a lot more beautiful. Can you just... Okay, so I'm two documents. So my name is Dixie Herring, and I am the head of the history department and the service master at the Washington, D.C. trip. So I'm going to go through this very, very quickly. If you have questions, you can ask me questions, but I'll roll through it pretty quickly. So next year's dates are April 27th to May the 3rd. We go from Saturday to Friday. So if you want to go with us, you have the dates to get off work. Our goal is 100% participation. We want 100% of our kids to go. This year we have 99 people going with us to D.C. Yes, we do fly. We do not drive. I would lose my mind and kick half your kids off the bus. So, we fly. You'll get it next year. So, the education value, the trip relates to our curriculum and brings history to life. What happens is this trip is the linchpin between ninth grade year and 10th grade year. The ninth grade year is early American history, and we will talk about this trip every single week as we're getting closer to it. And oh, by the way, we're going to see this, and oh, the Constitution. All right, so here's the Constitution. We're going to go to the National Archives and see the Constitution. So we talk about it the whole time. Then in 10th grade, they have modern American history, and they look back on the trip, and it becomes that linchpin between both years of class. So this is school. It's not a vacation. So they're going to learn, so it is, we count it as school days. There's a huge spiritual value to this. There's no nation like the USA. We are so blessed. We talk about our founding fathers and about faith and about how God has moved through our history. One of the things I say to my kids all the time, I don't know how you can study history and be an atheist. The more I study history, the more I am convinced of the hand of God in history. So we talk about that all year long, and then we get to go and see all this stuff. So then there's benefits of student field study. The journey provides an avenue for your kids to experience independence and self-discipline by budgeting, which is always fun. So your child will learn stewardship and time of money, or they will face the consequences thereof when they have no more money for any more DC back scratchers. So boy girl relationships, we are focused on protecting your child. That's my job. My job is not to make sure your kid has fun, because your kid will have fun. My job is to protect your child. This year I'm taking my nephew, it's the first family member I've taken. I'm super excited about it, and he's like my kid. And I treat your child exactly as I would treat my own flesh and blood. My job is protecting them. So because of that, no kids of the opposite sex are allowed in the same hotel rooms. This is strictly enforced. We have very strict rules that I go over with your kids over and over and over again before we fly out. They will have no question on what the expectations on the trip is. So the trip includes round trip air, all meals except the food in the airport on the way to DC, tour leader, tour guide, deluxe motor coach, 6 nights hotel accommodations, night security, all admissions, taxes, gratuities, photo, luggage checks, it's all included. The only thing you or your child will need to bring is spending money. Everything else is paid for. The 2018 price for this year is $2,255, so it stays right around there every year, kind of give or take 10, 15, 20 bucks, kind of seeing the way it goes. So that's about where it is. For adults in double occupancy, it's $2,605, and it depends on how many people are in your room is what your price is. So the price includes the $100 deposit that is due on October the 15th. And the prices will alter a little bit. Now let me say this just very quickly about that October 15th due date. Well, I'll say that in a minute. Okay, the payment plan, you pay every 15th of the month. We'll talk about that next year about how to do your payments. Now we have security. Again, my job is to protect your kids. So we have security guards every night who make sure your kids are safe in their rooms and in the hotels. We take security very seriously. If you flip over, there's a student behavior and conduct expectations. I go over this with the kids, hotel room behavior, airplane etiquette, overall trip behavior. We go through all of that, and that's a part of that growing up, maturing process, recognizing when to be silly and when to get control. This is an appropriate time to be running around and laughing. We're at the Vietnam Memorial. This is not an appropriate time to be running around and laughing. That's one of the things I trained them on how to recognize the appropriateness of things. All right, fundraising. The world's greatest car wash. We have one fundraiser. If you would like to hold your own, you may feel free. I will only, and we will only officially do one. So you can raise all of your money. If your kid works hard, we had one kid one year who went to everybody for this car wash, and she raised $2,800. It was her entire trip plus $500 spending money. So you can do it. Your kid can raise the money. Now, they've got to work hard, but they can do it. So when we start back in August, I'm going to have a meeting with all of you. I will explain this fundraiser. It's where they get sponsors. I'll explain the fundraiser. We'll get it all kicked off in that first meeting. And so that will be our first meeting as soon as we get back. We'll get this fundraiser kicked off because we want to have it while it's still warm. So parents and families, easy to register. So you can register at Academic Expeditions. They will give me registration information probably in August. When I get it, I will email it to you, and you need to register right away. I know that the registration date is October the 15th, but if we fill up, it's whenever we fill up. 2 years ago, we filled up on September the 15th, a whole month early. We filled every single place because we will only take 112 people. That's all the room and two buses. We won't go to a third bus because it increases. increases all of our prices. So you have to sign up by that point. If you don't sign up, or if you don't sign your child up, then they don't go. And I'm not gonna kick a parent off because I had a kid who doesn't sign up till later. So if you wanna sign up, you wanna go, please go. We love having parents go. We love having grandparents go. We love having siblings go. But you have to sign up right away. So I'll get that information to you as soon as I get it, which is probably gonna be in August. If you take a really quick look at it, I also handed you this. It's a frequently asked questions. I won't go through it. But it has a bunch of questions about registering and how much does it cost and all of that stuff. On the very back page, there's a question about chaperones. If I go, do I have to be a chaperone? No. Parents who go, you do not have to be a chaperone. In fact, you don't even have to speak to your child. It's your vacation. You don't have to even talk to your kid. I'm there to talk to your kid. I'm there to love your kid. You can ignore them. So you don't go as a chaperone. You get to go. It's totally your vacation. We take teachers to go as chaperones. And they're the ones that deal with discipline problems and telling kids, you know, to stop climbing up on different stuff and things like that. And so, so yes, we take teachers as chaperones. Just me. Oh, I'm sorry. Do we have some more green ones? Are we all out? Oh, here we go. They're still going around. Okay. So, yes, we got the green one has a bunch of stuff on it, so you can look through that. Does anybody have a quick question? This, by the way, is our, yeah. Oh, my little guy's up there. So, does anybody have a question for me really quickly? All right, if you have a question, you can email me, and then I'll see you in August, and we'll go over the whole thing in a lot of detail then.
Out loud that are still on your mind. If not, I'll just close this up.
I don't hear back from you, I'm assuming that your student is going to participate in that, but yes, we will have a room available for kids that don't want to attend that chapel. It's very age appropriate. This is a program that's been rolled out in the majority of the Catholic schools in the area, actually. They're tracking it through St. Al's. St. Al's is the sponsor of the program, and they're seeing really great results from it. They're seeing a 40% to 60% increase in students not contemplating or attempting suicide as a result of this program. So it's really being effective so far. Other questions about anything we've talked about tonight? Or any that's interesting? Okay, great. Thank you for coming. I'm gonna just close in prayer. Lord God, thanks for this time, and thanks for these parents who took time out of their busy schedules to be here tonight. And I just thank you for their children, Lord, and for bringing them here to Cole Valley. Thank you for the privilege that it is to teach and mentor them and disciple them each day. And I just pray that you would go before us as we continue to pour into these kids. Lord Jesus, may they know the hope that they have in you as they grow and as they mature. May they pursue you with their whole hearts.